everybody, and welcome to our webinar today. Hopefully you enjoyed a flashback to the 80s with a little Tears for Fears. That was Amy's request. My name is Allison O'Connor. I'm with CSU Extension in Larimer County. We're so pleased that you've joined us today. We hope to have a great attendance. My co-hosts are Cassie Anderson from Adams County and Mari Carmen Ortiz Castro, who is with the State Master Gardener Program. And I will introduce our speaker, Amy, in just one second once we get through a couple of housekeeping things. I do want to remind you that CSU is an equal opportunity access and non-discrimination university. If there's anything we can do to accommodate your needs, please let us know. We're happy to do that. Just as an FYI, the transcripts are on, and if you need to view those, you would control that with your own Zoom features. If you need any help, just reach out to one of us and we can help navigate that for you. And this webinar is being recorded. If you are here, you have registered. And don't worry if you need to leave us or we happen to run a little bit over. Everything will be recorded and we have your email address. And so this will be emailed to you once the webinar has been converted into a YouTube format. So look for that in your inbox within a week or so. We'll include any links or handouts that Amy wants to provide, and the email will come from her, so look for that. And it will also be posted to the cohort's blog, which one of us will put into the chat. And that's where you can sign up for future classes as well. So without further ado, I am so pleased to introduce my cohort, Amy Lentz. Amy is the Horticulture Specialist with Weld County Extension. So she's the neighboring county over. We're so pleased to have her here, and she's going to talk to you all about seed starting. And one thing I forgot, sorry, Amy, we are going to actually close down the chat. And so if you have questions, please use the Q&A feature on the bottom of your Zoom screen. Over to you, Amy.
Great. All right. Thanks, Allison. I'm going to go ahead and try to share my screen here. And does that look all right to you? Great. And I'm also going to go ahead and turn off my video just because it'll help with my bandwidth a little bit. Yes, great. Thank you so much, Allison, for the introduction. Let's start talking about seed starting. We have a lot to cover in today's class. We are going to cover, get my slide to change here. There we go. How seeds work. We're going to talk about outdoor sowing. We're going to talk about indoor sowing, the supplies that you'll need, including lighting and heat mats. We'll go through an example of how to schedule your seeds because all of them are different. We'll talk about hardening off the seedlings before planting. And then at the end, we'll go into specific crops. So hopefully I have time for all of this. It's a lot to pack into an hour. I also want to mention that we are starting to see big numbers for these webinars. So in the future, if you register, you'll get a link to the recording. We can only hold 500 max, so show up early, get your spot. All right, let's move on to today's class. So why should you start from seeds? There are a lot of different reasons here. It's cost effective. A pack of seeds, you know, is much cheaper than buying that one single plant at the garden center. You can look for hard to find species and varieties, things that are a little different. You can order these from all over the country. And then you can also save seeds and share seeds. And that's also fun too. You can pinpoint your timing if you start from seeds. We have a very short growing season in Colorado. Oh, depending on where you live, it's longer in some areas than others. But having that timing pinpointed can really help you get a crop before we get that fall frost. You have control over that seedling's growth. You can share your seedlings, and it's just fun. It's fun to play around with. It's fun to experiment. And I just love starting from seeds, something I do every year. So before we jump into how to start from seeds, I always like to give a little bit of a background science lesson. Let's look at the fundamentals of how seeds work. I think if you understand what's going on inside that seed, it's going to help you as you watch it grow and as you're taking care of it to get it to grow up to a good size. And just this picture here just kind of indicates you may not realize that seeds are literally all around us. They're in the food we eat, the flowers we grow, the grain crops that are growing. They're in the trees. Seeds are in the grass. It's literally, they're everywhere, but they're all a little bit different. So this picture here is just a typical dicot seed, and I wanted to show you the parts of that seed. So here we have the seed coat that surrounds the entire seed. Inside of that seed coat, you have what are called cotyledons, and that's these two sides here. The cotyledons are the food storage reserves for the little baby plant that's in there. And so you can see that little miniature plant there. It's got a plumule, that's the top growth. The radicle is another name for the root. And so as the seed grows, it's going to come out of that seed coat and sprout. So you'll never look at a bowl of peanuts the same way ever again. There's that little baby plant in there. You can see the plumule, you can see the radicle, and each of these halves is the cotyledon. Again, that's the food storage reserves for that little growing plant. We have two different kinds of seeds and two different kinds of plants. We have monocots and dicots. And now you know that that word monocot or dicot comes from the number of cotyledons on that seed. And so monocots have one cotyledon, dicots have two, so they have two halves. There are other differences between these types of plants, venation, vascular bundle arrangement, things like that. But for today's class, I just wanted to point out that that monocot has one cotyledon, dicots have two. You can see off to the side here all the different types of plants that fall into each of these categories as well. So here's just another picture there again, the dicot seed at the bottom. You can see that little miniature plant. It's the same thing in a monocot. It's just shaped a little bit differently. So I'm going to go back to the dicot example because I think it's just a little bit easier to understand and because it's more common. So what happens is once that seed coat is exposed to water, it starts to break down. And as it breaks down, that little root or that radicle will start to emerge and pop out of that seed. That's usually the start of germination. And so that root then will continue to grow, and then the seed will push itself up out of the soil by a structure called the hypocotyl. That's not important for you here today. And what you'll notice is those cotyledons then open up and true leaves emerge above them. And then the cotyledons will kind of shrivel up and eventually they may fall off. And so we get a lot of questions about what are these leaves falling off of my seedlings for? They're not actually leaves. They are the two sides of the seed that are being used up and spent by that little plant. So here you can see a picture of some seedlings. I believe these are cabbage or kale, one of the two. And what you see here are the cotyledons, and they look a little bit heart-shaped. Notice they don't have veins in them like you do with the regular true leaf. And so these were those two sides of that seed as it was growing. It expands, it does turn green because there's chlorophyll in there, but those will eventually drop off and you'll just be left with the true leaves. This is important for timing. I'm going to talk about this again when we talk about fertilizing your seedlings. So just hang on to that thought. So what to look at on a seed packet? Your seed packets are going to have a ton of information on them if they're the retail type. If it's from a big company, grab their catalog. If they don't have enough room on the seed packet, they'll put that information in their catalog. So what you're going to look for here are things like days to emergence. That's the number of days it takes for that seed to sprout out of the ground, that little root or that radical to anchor itself in the soil. That's emergence. Then you have days to maturity. This is the number of days it takes for that plant to produce a crop. We have information like a general planting window. You might take this with a grain of salt because we live in Colorado and things are very different here. But it'll also tell you how deep to plant that seed. If you're going to go directly into the ground, it'll tell you how much space to put between your seeds or between your rows. It might give you thinning instructions. We'll talk about that more a little bit later in the class as well. And then you might, if your packet has a lot of information on it, you might find outside and inside starting instructions. And then if you're growing flowers, you'll find more information about sun requirements, bloom time, and height of your flowers, because a lot of times those are used for cut flowers. So just know that there's a lot of information on that seed packet. Take the time to read it because each different crop is going to be very different, as you'll notice from today's class. So there are two main ways to start from seeds. You can start indoors or you can start outdoors. And so I'm going to go ahead and start with the outdoor sowing first, because I think it's a little bit more simple and we'll get that out of the way. And then we'll go into starting from seeds indoors. So when do you start your seeds outside? It's a good question. And again, every seed is different. So basically your soil temperature is going to be the best thing to help you determine when to plant. And it'll tell you, I'm going to tell you in this class of different temperatures that these different crops prefer. And so that's what you're going to want to measure. You're going to want to make sure that soil is warm enough. So you're measuring about 4 inches deep, about 8 o'clock in the morning or any time in the morning, you know, before the sun gets up and beats down on the soil. If you are going to try to raise those soil temperatures, you can do that. I'm going to show you some pictures here in a second of how to do that. But just know that dry soils are going to warm pretty quickly. But if your soil is wet, it's going to warm more slowly. And so just something to consider. All right, this is a really big chart. I'm going to break it down for you here. We're going to look at seeds commonly planted directly into the soil, not necessarily started inside. And here you can see that those temperatures, those soil temperatures are going to be affecting whether or not these seeds grow or not. And so you see a minimum here of 40 degrees. Yeah, great. We can get 40 degree soils, you know, pretty early on in the spring. That's the minimum. It's not the optimum. And so here you can see optimum temperatures are more around 80 degrees. And so basically you'll still get germination at 40 degrees. It's going to take a really long time. Maybe some of your seeds will sprout, some of your seeds won't. It's not going to be very uniform. The closer you get to this optimum, the more uniform your germination is. So raising those soil temperatures again can be done. You can do this with raised beds pretty easily. You can do it with in-ground beds as well. They don't have to be raised beds. And all you're going to do is basically either cover up the whole bed, like you see in the picture here, with some sort of structure to capture that heat, almost like a greenhouse, unheated greenhouse, or you can use what's called plastic mulch to warm the soil. And that's really just a fancy name for black plastic. So here's a picture for you. We're going to look at this middle row, and this is a lettuce crop. And so what is happening here is you can tell it's early in the season, maybe because they've got these row covers up for frost protection. But see this big roll of, whoops, of black plastic, there we go, covering up this row of lettuce. And so what they've done is they've started way back here in the back, and they've done what's called succession planting. And as they plant, they're pulling back this black plastic that's been warming the soil. And so these are older. And then once those sprout, then they'll plant another set, they'll let those sprout, plant another set, and continually rolling this plastic back, because that plastic is going to trap that heat from the sun hitting it into the soil. So when you're sowing your seeds outdoors, there's a couple rules here you just want to follow. Generally speaking, your larger seeded crops are better sown directly outside. That's a big generalization. There are exceptions to the rule. Root crops, however, you should always be planting those directly into the soil. And that's just because that little tiny root ends up being the eating part of the crop. So like with carrots, if you start these indoors, that root is going to hit the bottom of that little container very quickly and turn and go upwards, and you're going to end up with some really strange looking root crops if you try to do those indoors. So let's go ahead and plant those directly outside. When you do this, you want to prepare your garden, and I don't mean your whole garden, just where you're planting the seeds. So maybe just like a 3 or 4 inch wide space. You want to prepare that with really nice fine soil that you've broken down that's even and level. You can even do like a little trench and add in some finer soil into that trench and then seed into that. You just want to remove any large stones or weeds, because it's going to be hard for that little tiny plant to, you know, turn over a stone to get itself out of the ground. Couple more tips about sowing seeds outdoors, and then we'll move on to the indoor seeding. So you want to plant according to the depth that's recommended on the seed packet. A general rule here is twice the width of the seed. So if your seed is a half inch wide, you're going to plant it an inch deep. Some seeds are really tiny though, so you may want to put those directly on the soil surface. And if they need light to germinate, which it'll tell you on the packet, you just want to put those onto the soil surface, tamp them down very lightly, and don't cover them. Make sure that your seeds do have good contact with the soil. Again, just very light tamping down will help make a good seed to soil contact. You want to water immediately after you plant, but you want to do this very gently because you don't want to disturb those seeds you've just planted. And if you flood the area, those seeds might even float up to the top and start to make their way down that stream of water to one end of your garden bed. And then you've got all of your stuff at one end. So you can use something like this. This is called a foget nozzle. You can attach this to your hose and it just creates a very fine mist. But there are other types of heads you can use as well, or you can use a very small watering can. Just make sure that you're gently watering. Now for some other crops, some smaller seeded crops like lettuce and radish, those they're too hard to get the spacing correct. So what you do is you just plant them heavy in a row, and then you go back and you thin those little seedlings to the recommended spacing. It might seem like a waste of seed, but in this case for like lettuce, like you see in the picture here, that you're gonna get hundreds of seeds in that packet and it's gonna be pretty cheap. So you can kind of, it's not really a waste of your money necessarily. You can, if you're careful enough, take those little seedlings that you've pulled out and transplant them in other places as well. You wanna wait to do this until you start to see those first set of true leaves. Just give it time to establish so that you don't disturb what's around it. And then for your larger seeded crops, so like pumpkins or melons or things like that, go ahead and space them according to the recommendation, but double up in the hole. So put two or three or even four seeds in a hole. And then once you get those seedlings to pop up out of the ground, you can thin it back to one or two plants per hole. Days to maturity for directly sown seeds is typically from the date that you put that seed into the ground until it gets to maturity for harvest. So it's a little different for seeds that are typically transplanted. It's going to tell you this on the seed packet, hopefully. Okay, so that's all I'm going to cover for outdoor seeding until we get to the specific crops at the end of the class. So if I didn't cover your question, you can pop that into the Q&A. But I'm going to go ahead and move on to indoor seeding because there is a lot to unpack here. So when you're starting seeds indoors, there's a lot of good advantages to doing this. First, you have the optimal environment because you're going to be able to create it. You've got to manage that environment too, though. So you've got to be on top of your seedlings for a couple, maybe 2 or 3 months. You're going to get more uniform germination because we're going to provide exactly what those seeds want. And so they're all going to pop up at a similar time and grow at a similar rate. You're going to have more control over your spacing. You can see in this bottom right-hand picture here, you know, using transplants, if it tells you 6 inches between plants, well, you can easily measure that and plant according to the directions instead of going out and trying to plant seeds 6 inches apart and hoping that they come up out of the ground. And you won't have those missed spots either. It helps with our short growing season. The higher up you are in elevation, the shorter your growing season. Also, the further south you go, the longer your growing season. So here in Colorado, that can range from like 45 days all the way up to 150 days, depending on where you are. If you're in like the southeast or the southwest corner, you're looking at a much longer growing season. Here along the Front Range, 100 days, maybe a little more, is about what we're looking at here. Also, starting your seeds indoors, big incentive here is it saves you money. It's cheap to buy seeds, expensive to buy plants. So here are some supplies to start your seeds at home that you're gonna wanna consider. I'll go over containers in more detail, but you're gonna want a variety of containers. Humidity control. Something like a tent, like you see in the bottom picture here, or they have those domes that fit the flats that you can just pop onto the top. You'll want to use a seed starting mix. I skipped over that one. I've got a picture and a couple slides here to show you the difference between a seed starting mix and a regular potting mix. And it's pretty, I think it's a pretty big difference. You might need a heat mat, not a total requirement. You can get away without one, but it certainly will help your seedlings germinate again more uniformly. You'll want a timer for that heat mat if you've got one, just less for you to have to think about. Labels, very important that you label all these seedlings, especially if you're growing multiple varieties of the same crop like tomatoes. All tomato seedlings are going to look pretty darn similar. So you're going to want to label them and make sure you understand which ones go with which label. Lights, probably a requirement for most people. And then a fan. And so I'm going to show you a quick, you might be like, a fan? What's that for? Let me show you a quick video here of a fan blowing over some seedlings. So I've got a fan off here to the left. This is at my house a few years ago, and you can see it's blowing across those seedlings, creating that wind. What this fan is doing is it's strengthening the stems of those seedlings. They're having to beef up their stem structure because they want to be able to withstand that wind. I will obviously be rotating those plants around as well. Just some of them will be getting more wind the closer they are to the fan. So that's a reason to use a fan. Here are some containers that you can use. So plastic cell packs, these are probably the most common thing that people use, but you can also use open flats, like the one you see here without the Jiffy pots inside of it, will just be an example of an open flat. Or you can use these Jiffy Pro Jiffy pots. You can repurpose kitchen containers like this clamshell down here, maybe a strawberry container, a grape container. I do this a lot. Or you can use little cups, little Dixie cups, or, you know, the dental kind of dentist cups. And just make sure if you're using things that are not typically made for starting seeds that you're providing drainage holes, or you're very closely monitoring the water inside that container. Let's talk a little bit about seed starting mix. There is a difference between seed starting mix and potting mix. They're all made from the same basic components. So vermiculite, that's this light brown pile up here on the top. That is mica, which is a mineral, a platy mineral that they've puffed up, heated up, and it puffs up like popcorn, and it absorbs water. So it actually helps retain moisture in the mix. Then you have perlite, that's the white, more rocky thing here. That's a volcanic rock, very highly heated. And so that actually provides air space. And then you have this either peat moss or coconut core, and that's going to provide more of the organic type mix part of that media. So here is an example of seed starting mix on the left and potting mix on the right. And you can see, yes, huge difference. This seed starting mix is much more finely ground down. It's going to contain a little bit more of the peat moss here. Whereas you see in the potting mix, it's more rocky. It has bigger types of debris or plant debris in it. And so better for established plants on the right, seed starting on the left. So definitely, invest in some seed starting mix. It's not too expensive. One bag will go a really long way because you really aren't using too much of it for those little containers. Watering your seedlings and your seeds, you want to water with a very light stream of water. So you can use mist heads, like I showed you before, for your hoses. A small watering can be useful. I personally, this is my go-to when I'm starting seeds indoors, is this measuring cup, because I can get really close right down at the seedling level and water very slowly and get a good soak. Water, really important. So you might even use a mist out of a spray bottle. Fertilizing your seedlings. So here's another thing to consider. Do you have to fertilize your seedlings? Don't have to. It's really not a requirement. You will want to fertilize, you know, at planting if you don't fertilize while you're growing them. But if you need to move them along and you need some more growth, or you're just noticing that they look a little bit pale, kind of a pale green or yellow color, maybe they just need a little bit more nutrients in their growing media. And so you can use what's called a starter fertilizer. So here's an example at the top of a starter fertilizer. Notice that the middle number, which is phosphorus, is a little bit higher in a starter fertilizer. And that's because phosphorus is really good for root growth, for cell elongation, for cell division, things that are going on at that molecular level inside the plant to get it to grow. These are going to be mixed at a very, very low concentration. They're not going to be super blue in color or anything. Just a little bit of nutrients can go a long way. But be careful. Wait until you see those first set of true leaves. Remember, those cotyledons are going to look different. If you're just seeing the cotyledons, it's way too early to fertilize. Wait till you see that first set of true leaves. And I even like to say, wait till those expand. Not that they just show up, but wait until they fully expand. And then you want to fertilize. Now, just so you know, your potting mix, your starting media, it does have a slight charge to it. And so there will be a little bit of nutrient in there for your seedlings to work off of for a little while. Lighting. This is the one that I probably get the most questions about. And so here are the questions I get. Is supplemental lighting needed? And my answer is probably, yeah. It depends on, you know, your exposure of your window and things like that. So maybe. What kind of light should you be using? There's a lot of different types of grow lights out there. Some of them get hot. Heat-wise, they get hot. They might have bright light, but they're probably not the best for a home use. They're more commercial made. I personally think that LEDs are the best for home use. Is a window location enough? I don't know. Again, it depends on your exposure. It depends on, here in this picture, you can see how far this eave hangs over the window. So I love what they did here. They created a shelving unit. And I don't know if you can tell, but those shelves are tipped up just a little bit. So those aren't flat, and just kind of helping those seedlings get a little bit more sun. Is that going to be enough? I don't know. Again, it all depends. Here's how you can tell. You want to see seedlings that look like this. Nice, short, squatty seedlings. And notice those cotyledons there. We haven't seen true leaves yet. They're very close to the soil. So that seedling is emerging and not stretching. That's good. That means you have enough light. If your seedlings look like this, again, see those cotyledons, it's stretching underneath those cotyledons. That's the hypocotyl there. That tells me that you're not getting enough light. Those seedlings are stretching. So I'd rather you see this. And how do you get that? You need to place those lights really close down to the seedlings. So somewhere between, you know, maybe 2 to 6 inches above the top of that seedling. And then as it grows, you can lift those lights up. It doesn't have to be right on top, but it will definitely, definitely give you a different appearance to your seedlings. So we don't want to see that. Don't want to see those long, leggy seedlings. Okay, let's talk a little bit about temperature now to get your seedlings to sprout. So another really big chart, we're going to break it down for you. Here you can see these are seeds that are commonly started indoors under these higher temperatures. So look at the optimums. We're at 80, 85, 90. Really, you can't get that going directly into the soil in the spring when you're trying to grow these plants. So most heat mats are generally around 75 to 80 degrees, which is perfect for these seedlings to sprout. And so there you can see that heat mat. You just want to put your tray or your container directly onto that heat mat, and it's going to provide that heat through and help help those seedlings out. Here's a picture of a very simple setup I did a few years back. This is my kitchen countertop. I just mounted one of those little LED grow lights underneath. It's not being held up by the tape. There's actually a couple screws in there holding those lights up. And then I plugged it in with a timer. You can see my heat mat peeking out there underneath my containers. I love these little containers because I can move them on, move them off, switch them around. But what I want you to notice right now is that the light is out and the humidity tents are on, trapping that heat. Now here is another picture of that same setup. You can see the light up here. The light is on, the domes are off. You don't want to create a greenhouse effect inside that little dome by having a heat mat on the bottom and then light coming down from the top with this cover on it, because it's going to trap way too much heat. You can see the condensation in there as well, trapping that water. So make sure if your lights are on or it's daytime that your domes, humidity domes are off. And then I like to put those on as soon as the lights go out or the sun goes down. I like to put those domes back on, trapping that heat overnight and then taking them off again in the morning when the lights come back on. I do want to mention there is a seedling disease that we see quite often. It's called damping off. It's just when these young little seedlings can't handle the hot, humid environment they're in. And there's a fungus or a water mold that will come in and start to kill off those seedlings. So it's either Rhizoctonia or Pythium that's doing this. So what you'll see seedlings that don't come out of the mix. Cotyledons are soft or mushy. Maybe the stems are thin or thread-like. They wilt, they turn grayish brown. They might get kind of a fuzz or a webby mold to show up as well. So this is called damping off. And this means that you're too wet, too hot. What can we do? So to prevent this, there are some things you can do. You want to clean and sanitize your seed trays, your equipment, because again, it is either a fungus or a mold that can come on from years past. So make sure you're cleaning your equipment. Use sterile soilless media that's clean. I do not recommend reusing potting mix when you're growing seedlings because again, it's just such a moist, wet environment. It's hot and it's ripe for growing things like molds. Now I'm not so much worried about this little bit of green algae growth that's on top of the soil. That can indicate that you're watering too much, but that also is just a very common thing. So two separate things here. So monitor your moisture levels, monitor your heat temperature of your mats. Low light can contribute to this as well. Overwatering, high salts, all of these can contribute to damping off. And I should mention cool or warm conditions can bring this on. Okay, we're covering a lot. We're gonna shift gears. What I want to do is I want to go through an example with you of how to plan out your crop schedule, because each seed is going to be different. So when you look at that seed packet, you're looking for a few different things. You're looking for the number of days it takes to germinate or sprout that seedling for it to pop up out of the ground. You're looking at how long it's going to take until that seedling then develops into a size that's good enough to go outside, that's going to make it. Then you got to consider your frost dates. We've got a last frost in the spring, which, you never know when that's going to happen. I've seen it happen into June before. But you also have that first frost in the fall you have to consider as well. And then you have to think about the number of days it takes to get that harvest. And are you going to make it in time for Colorado's short season? So I would say pick varieties that mature faster. If this is an issue for you, and if you're not using season extension techniques to help make that season a little bit longer. All right, here's that, another one of those charts again. I would like to focus in here on tomato. So this chart, I should say these charts, both of the ones I've showed so far, are available in our garden notes online. So you can look these up. What this one shows is more of a timing thing. This is for transplanting or planting outdoors, and it'll tell you how long it takes for a seed to sprout and then how long until the typical days of harvest. Now with this one, it's also giving you how long it takes to grow a transplant. The ones that have the asterisk here, that days to maturity is from transplanting, not from the time you plant the seed. So, they always like to confuse us. So give yourself plenty of time. So let's look at tomato. So here's I just printed off this little, I just copied off this little calendar for 2023. And let's get started here. So first thing we need to look at, last frost date. Typically speaking, May 15th for Colorado, that's what the maps will tell you. Mother's Day this year is on May 14th. I personally think that's too early for tomatoes. Tomatoes are a very tender crop. They love that warmth. They do not like to be cold. And so for me, I like to say, let's just wait until Memorial Day weekend. So I'm going to circle here on our chart, May 28th. That's my goal for planting my tomatoes. Now I need to look at my days to maturity for this particular variety that I'm looking at here. It said on the packet 77 days. So that's about 11 weeks. I should be seeing tomatoes by August 13th. I think I'm good with that. Now, if you're trying to enter into the county fair and it's at the end of July, you might want to back this up a couple weeks, add some season extension, try your best to push that harvest, but I'm okay with this. Now we need to look at how to grow that seedling and have it be ready to plant on that date of the 28th. So total seedling time here is 6 to 9 weeks. That's taking into account our seedling growth, which is about 7 weeks, and our germination. Now, I would like to also harden these plants off for a week or so. So I would like them to be ready to go outside by the 21st of May, even though I'm not going to plant till the 28th. So we're going to work backwards. There is my seedling growth time. About 7 weeks takes me back to April 8th, but I have to consider the time to germinate as well. So we're looking at somewhere around March 31st. Now, for a lot of you, you might be like, oh no, I already did my tomatoes. I planted them yesterday, and you're like a whole month and a half early. That's okay. You'll just need to continually step those up into larger and larger containers as they become root bound. And you'll just be going into the garden with a bigger transplant. So that's kind of a rundown of how you would plan your crop schedule. You can do this for each different crop separately to help you kind of make these decisions, but just know that there are, again, exceptions to the rule. Seedlings can get transplant shock. So despite your best efforts of putting them out on May 28th, maybe we get a frost or we get a really cold early June. They're going to slow down. Sometimes they can take longer in Colorado's climate. So that 77 days might actually be 88 days. The days to maturity, this is just a side note for things that are typically transplanted. They're telling you the days to maturity from the date of transplant. Read the seed packet. That's my tip for all of these crops. So generally speaking, not including the time to sprout, cucumbers, melons, squash, and lettuce are pretty quick, 2 to 4 weeks. Broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, those cole crops, and tomatoes, 5 to 7 weeks. Bigger, beefier type tomatoes, indeterminate heirloom types might take a little longer. Cherry tomatoes might go a little quicker. Eggplant, leeks, onions, peppers, and some herbs, about 6 to 9 weeks. But the flowers are all over the board. Some flowers take 10 or more weeks to get to a seedling size. Some flowers are really quick, and I'll cover these specifically at the end. So planting your transplants outside. So we've grown up this transplant, we're ready to go. It's what was that date? It was like May 21st. I'm starting to harden off my tomato seedlings. And I do this by taking them outside, putting them in the, and I'm going to say this a couple times, putting them in the shade or the dappled shade the first few days, and then bringing them back in the middle of the day when it's nice and warm. And then the next day you can increase that by maybe, an hour or two. And eventually you can move them out of that dappled shade into more sun as they get more size onto them. It's like dipping your toe into the water. You don't want to do it really fast. We're not diving in the deep end. We are stepping into the baby pool. So just keep all that in mind. Water your seedlings well and frequently. Water them before you put them out or as you put them out, and water them again while they're outside. They have very tiny little cells. And those little cells will, cells being the little container, those will dry up very quickly because there's just not a lot of mix in there. So water frequently. And then when you're ready to plant, if it's a hot day, you want to bring your transplants out slowly, put them in the shade, don't put them right out into full sun, and then try to plant all day long because they're going to dry up. Okay. So this is a good stopping point. Real quick, I'll just see if we have any questions that are burning. Allison, Cassie, Mari.
Yes, so we had several questions and I kind of like grouped them into two.
Okay.
The first one is about light. It is your opinion about red light, blue light, purple light, or white light. Mm-hmm. And what are some good types of lights that you recommend for people that are going to use those grow lights?
Great. That's a great question. So the spectrum of light is important. Plants want red light. They want blue light. And so having a combination of red and blue is what you're looking for. That's why those LEDs, when they light up, they look purple because they're providing those red and blue wavelengths. That's what you need. Fluorescent lights, they don't provide the exact wavelength that plants need. They can help a little bit, but they're not going to be optimum. Halogen lights, there are specific ones that work specifically for crops, but they're going to get, or those metal halide type lights, they're going to get hot. And so I'm always going back to the LEDs. I think the LED lights that are specific for plants are the way to go. Incandescent lights, like a typical light bulb, is not going to do much of anything. So LEDs, plant lights are great. You can get these. They can link together. They're not too terribly expensive. Maybe 20 bucks or so, 20 to 30 bucks for a light. And you can even just buy the bulbs. So you can use like a shop light with big long bulbs in it, and you can just switch those out with plant lights. So does that answer that one, Madi?
Yes, great. Thank you. Okay. And then the other one that they have is about if you can share some pros and cons about seed blockers versus containers. And I guess I'm going to add another one versus egg cartons and all those type of containers.
Great. Yeah, there's a lot of options you can use for containers. You can even make containers out of newspaper with origami if you really want to. It doesn't matter as long as there's good drainage and as long as that container can hold up for the length of the time that seedling needs to grow. So newspaper will start to break down after a couple months, but if it's some of those shorter crops, you can use that. The little blocks that you get, they can dry out kind of quickly. So you just have to monitor those pretty well. Sometimes they have like almost like a pantyhose sock around them. So they don't have actual container walls that are keeping that moisture in. They're much more open to the air. So those might dry out faster. But there's a lot of options you can use. You can use egg crates. You can use, I use the little cups because they're cheap, and I just poke little holes in the bottom with thumbtacks, you know, to give me drainage. So there's a lot that you can do here. I try not to give one specific recipe because there is a million different ways to grow plants. So just monitor your moisture level is my tip, and use seed starting mix or use the blocks that are made for seed starting.
Great. Thank you.
Great.
See, we right. are good.
Okay. Well, let's move on then. I'm going to cover in the last 15 minutes here, some specific crops, when to transplant, when to direct sow, stuff like that. So let's get started here. I'm going to kick it off with our favorite. Everybody wants to grow tomatoes and peppers. Some people like eggplant too. All of these fall into this solanaceous crops group. And so typically tomatoes about 6 to 9 weeks, again, depending on the type. Peppers take a little bit longer, about 8 to 10 weeks, as well as eggplant, about seven to 10 weeks, depending on the type. And that's to get yourself up to a seedling size ready for transplant. So here's the answer to your question, Madi. Look at these containers down here. They're just made out of old boxes. You can totally do that. You want to plant your seeds with tomatoes, peppers, and eggplants very shallow, just a quarter of an inch deep. Those seeds are very small, about an eighth inch in diameter. And so again, twice the width of the seed is a good rule. The germination temperature of these, the media, should be around 80 degrees to get ideal germination. Peppers love it hot. So they really love that 80 degree germination from that heat mat underneath. These are all very tender crops. Hardening off your tomatoes, peppers, and eggplants is very important. So a week, maybe even almost 2 weeks of taking them outside, bringing them back in, monitoring the weather. Don't leave them out there if it's gonna be too cold. You can leave them out overnight as long as it doesn't get below like 55. So generally you're bringing them out and in, back and forth for a couple weeks. Also consider delaying that transplanting time until 1 to 2 weeks after that frost date, like I showed you in the chart there. That's just getting you past those colder temperatures. There are things you can use, you know, season extension type things to push this and get planted out earlier. You can try those certainly, but I like to just wait. I feel like the plants will catch up. And then finally, this is a good tip for tomatoes, and tomatillos, I believe, will also work with this. You can plant these deep, and I'm going to show you a picture of this. Look how deep this person is planting that tomato plant. So what they've done is they've stripped all these lower leaves off, and they're sinking that thing down in the ground. Because tomatoes, unlike any other crop, they grow roots on their stems. So all these little nubs that you see here, those are gonna turn into roots. And this will be a question we often get at the help desk of what is on, like, I think my plant has a disease, or it looks like it has pimples on the stem. Don't fear, those are root nodules. And so if you plant those deep and those turn into roots because they've now can make contact with the soil, you have just doubled or tripled the size of your root system for that tomato plant, which means it's going to take up more water, it's going to take up more nutrients, and you're going to get a bigger plant out of that by planting it deep. Again, only for tomatoes, and Cassie can answer in the chat if I'm wrong, but some tomatillos I think will do this as well. Okay. Here's another example of that. You can do them sideways. Maybe you don't have, you know, a foot of rooting depth down there. You can go sideways as well. It'll be the same effect. Just make sure you pop the top of that plant out of the soil. All right, cool crops. So here's another one, another type of crop. This contains broccoli, cabbage, cauliflower, kohlrabi, kale. All of these are cold crops, not cold. They're not freezing. They are in the mustard family, and coal is another word for mustard. So these are mustard crops. These are going to germinate in soil temperatures as low as 40 degrees, but their optimal temperature is 80. So they're going to do much better in warmer soil. And this is why a lot of people typically start these from transplants in the spring. I had a question come in before the webinar that someone put on one of the advertisements about how do you know when a transplant is ready? And for these coal crops, you can see the root system here. Look at that nice white roots just starting to hit the edge of the container, not root bound yet. And then on the top growth here, you've got about 4 inches of top growth. You can see those cotyledons there off to the side, true leaves in the center, and that little seedling is about 4 inches tall. That is how you know when a coal crop seedling is ready. It'll take you about 5 weeks to get to that point. As far as planting the seeds into that soil mix, you're looking at just a half inch deep. These are very small seeds as well. And also hardening those seedlings off before transplanting is important here. Coal crops can take cooler temperatures, so you can put these out in the garden earlier than you can your tomatoes and your peppers. Usually a couple weeks before that last frost. They can take a light frost. Have your row cover ready to throw over the top if we start to get much colder temperatures. But because these are going out into colder temperatures, hardening them off is going to be as equally important as it was for the tomatoes. Cucurbits, these are things like cucumbers, squash, melons, pumpkins. This group, their roots are extremely intolerant of being disturbed. They do not like to be disturbed. And so oftentimes we say it's best to just go ahead and direct seed these into the ground. And if you do that, you're looking at a depth of about an inch because these seeds are bigger. They're about a half inch wide. This is where I would, if you're going to go directly into the ground, especially with things like pumpkins and some of your squashes, put 2 or 3 or 4 seeds in the hole and then thin back to 1 or 2 plants. With your vining crops like pumpkins and melons, it's one big long vine, right? So you can do 2 seeds that sprout into 2 seedlings and leave both of those seedlings and just send them off in different directions. So you can actually leave back 2 seedlings per hole for these. Or you can do transplants. It can be done. As you can see in both of these pictures, these are very small young plants. Just one set of true leaves. And really just one of those true leaves is expanded. So as soon as you start to see these leaves expanding, it's time to go ahead and transplant your cucurbit crops. And this can take just 2 to 3 weeks. It's very short. So these are always the last thing I am seeding out indoors before I, at the end of the seed starting process, because they just don't take much time at all. And their ideal germination temperature is 90 degrees. You're not going to get that outside unless you're warming the soil. So another reason to plant inside. And when you do plant, get all of that media. Try not to disturb those roots and put all of that in the ground. You don't want to bare root these. Harden them off before you transplant. Again, always important. All right, peas. Peas are kind of a different one altogether. These can go directly outside very early in the spring, about 4 to 6 weeks before the last frost. So around, St. Patrick's Day is a good time, or a little after St. Patrick's Day, maybe up to Easter, you want to be planting these peas. They can germinate as low as 40 degrees, but they prefer usually up around 80. Space your seeds about 4 to 6 inches apart. Again, read those seed packets. They're going to tell you what the spacing should be. Now, here's a tip for you. Because they do like those warmer temperatures to germinate, you can grow these indoors, and it's what we call pre-sprouting. So you're going to get a wet paper towel, put your seeds on that wet paper towel, roll it up, stick it in a plastic bag to help keep it moist, and then give it a couple days, like maybe 6 to 15 days. Actually, let me change that. You're going to want to check this after about 4 days. As soon as you start to see those little roots pop out, you can go ahead and plant these directly into the ground. The process that starts that germination, once it starts, it doesn't stop. So as soon as the seed gets that signal to push that radical out from that seed coat, that's sprouting. So if you get to that point, you can go ahead and put it into the garden. And then you're looking at about 65 days until harvest. And then you're going to pull the plants out because it's going to get too hot in the middle of the summer for peas to grow. Lettuce, bib lettuce, romaine lettuce, loose leaf lettuce. These are all different types of leafy greens. And so these are fun because you can actually start around inside as transplants 2 to 3 weeks prior to whenever you want to plant outside. And then you can direct sow outside, like we saw in the picture there, in rounds. So maybe you plant several plants, wait a couple weeks, plant another group, wait a couple weeks, plant another group. And this will help extend the harvesting. You'll have much more to harvest for a longer period of time. Now, look for varieties when you're spring planting that mature in about 50 days. Or so, because they start to, once we get in the heat of the summer months, they start to kind of putter out. They might bolt, they might flower, something like that. But generally, they're done in the hot months of the summer, unless you're providing shade or something like that. Head types, if you're wanting to grow those, they're better planted midsummer after that summer solstice, because the flowering is affected by the number of hours of light. So wait till summer solstice, plant your head types then directly outside or indoors, either way. Use a shallow planting for lettuce, just a 1/4 inch to a 1/2 inch. Some lettuce will tell you that it needs light to germinate, in which case you're just gonna put it on the top of the soil. Now you can use, if you remember back from when I talked about that product called vermiculite that absorbs water, it's like a little tiny miniature sponge. You can sprinkle that around on top of the seeds, and that'll help keep the moisture level right, but it'll still allow a little bit of light in. Just don't go real heavy. 5 to 6 weeks from seed to baby greens. It's pretty quick. And then salad size within 6 to 8 weeks. And then you can even harvest lettuce as little tiny seedlings, and those are microgreens. So you can get those in just 1 to 2 weeks. Spinach, pretty similar, but it's a little more cold tolerant. And so you can go earlier with spinach, about 2 to 4 weeks before your last frost. It's going to grow as low as 40 degrees outside. It's going to be fine and happy. It can handle a frosty nip. And then again, similar to the leaf lettuces, you're going to want to pull it out midsummer. It's going to start to putter out. And then you can do a second round in late summer, because spinach and lettuce, these are all pretty quick crops. Root crops, beets, carrots, radishes, 2 to 4 weeks before your last frost, you want to go directly in the ground. Remember, root crops always go directly in the ground because you're growing the root to eat. So they'll germinate from 35 all the way up to 80. This is where you might want to warm the soil with some black plastic and then plant your seeds. You can keep them covered with that plastic for a day or two or three, but then pull it off and you should start to see some germination. About 7 to 14 days. So be patient. I know that sometimes I've planted carrots in the past and I'm thinking they didn't germinate. And then lo and behold, a couple weeks later, there they are. Overseed your rows, and then go back and thin to the required spacing. And just know that you can get a root crop pretty quick. So those radish up at the top there may be ready to harvest within 30 days if you hit the timing right. And then here's just another tip. If you're growing beets and Swiss chard, so that's the picture here in the upper left, they have a very corky outer covering that sometimes it's hard for water to penetrate. And so it's best to soak those for a couple hours before you plant. And also know that they will have more than one seed or seedling per seed. They're multi-germ. They do make single seeded beets. There's a variety called Solo, which only puts out one plant per seed. But typically you're going to get multiple plants per seed that you might have to thin back. All right, I've got a couple more. I think we'll be done right on time. Beans, we've got bush beans and pole beans. Go directly outside with this. You can do transplants, but I think your plants are gonna catch up. Wait till the temperatures are 60 degrees in your soil before you plant in the ground, and go to about a depth of 1 to 1.5 inches. And then finally, our flowers and herbs. Remember, I said these are all over the place. So I remember I used to grow petunias and I would start those in January, but then I would grow things like zinnias and marigolds, and those only take a few weeks before they're up to seedling size. So read your seed packets. It really is dependent on the type of flower. And then they might even have dormancy breaking techniques that you need to add, like cold stratification or scarification. And you're going, what's that? Well, stratification, cold stratification and warm stratification are just moist treatments where that seed is going through a period of either cold, moist or warm, moist environment, and it will help it break that dormancy. It needs that freezing and thawing kind of back and forth to help it wake up. And then it will push the root out of that, or the radical or the root out of that seed. But it won't do that unless it gets the right number of weeks of cold or the right number of weeks of warm. Typically speaking, this is for your perennial seeds. Some tree seeds are like this. I used to do work with burning bush, and it was like several weeks of warm, followed by cold, followed by warm. It just took a lot to get that seed to sprout. And then scarification, this is just the process of actually scratching that seed coat to help break through it, because it's impermeable to water. So the water can't get into the seed until it has a little nick in it. And so that's scarification. Again, this is typically for perennials or tree seeds, harder seeded things, probably not your vegetable seeds. So we covered a lot in today's class. If you want to learn more about growing food, we have a website called Grow and Give. It's a program where you can grow food and donate it for, to your local community, but it's also a learning resource. And so if you go onto that website, look under Growing Food, and you'll find a link to our Colorado Vegetable Guide. This is 85 pages of crop by crop information. It's going to have specific crops. It's going to tell you all about growing those specific crops. And then it also has some really great charts for troubleshooting later on in the season with diseases and insects. So with that, I'm going to stop and see if we have any more questions in the Q&A.
Thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it on behalf of Colorado State University Extension. Have a great afternoon.